Fine, so welcome to the day 2. I'll just create a new Java project known as day 2. Okay, and out here I'll be starting off with the concepts of object oriented programming. Fine, because yesterday we saw that I told you that everything is inbuilt and all everything, and you just need to know the commands, and to know the commands and to execute them effectively, you need to know about the object oriented concepts in Java language. Okay. Right, so in the source folder which you have, I'll just create a new class. Fine, and suppose I name that class as say phone. Okay, phone.java without the main function. Okay, now what all properties does a phone have? Okay, for example, I'll just write over here public string name, the name of the phone. Okay, phone has a property known as name. Okay, public string name. Alright, now suppose if there is another class known as say user with the main function. Okay, now this class can be executed because it's got the main function under it. If my voice is breaking, you can let me know. Okay, at times sometimes issues happen, right? If my voice is not clear, you can let me know. Okay, so this is the user class with the main function. Okay, in the main function I can create object of phone class. Okay, how do I create? I write over here new phone. By writing the keyword new along with the class name phone, you can create the object of the class phone. Now what does this do? How is it helpful? Okay, we write it like this and the object of the class is created, but how is it helpful? Look, the thing is, when you create the object in the memory, right, in the memory the object of the phone class is created and it's got the property say name. We had a property name in the phone, right? In phone.java we have a property name. Okay, so when you create the object of the user class, okay, in the memory the name property goes. If I create the object say 3 times, then 3 different objects are created in the memory. Every object will have the property phone. Okay. Right. Sorry, name, not phone, name. Okay, sorry. Okay, but you cannot access these objects. To access these objects, you need to have the object reference. Okay? Right. So these are the 3 objects which I have created, but I cannot access them in the memory. They are just present in the memory. Okay. To access these objects, you need to have something known as object reference. Okay, now what do you mean by object reference? You need, like, you create the object like this, say phone p equals to new phone. What is the advantage of this? If you create the object like this, then in the memory phone object is created, inside it you have the property name and p is pointing towards this, say p1, I'll call it p1. So p1 is pointing towards this particular object in the memory. Okay, so p1 is known as object reference. P1 is object reference, And phone is object. There is a difference between object reference and object. Object reference points towards the object. Okay, phone is an object. Alright. With P1 you can access the state of the object. If I write P1 dot, you will get the property name. Automatically Eclipse shows this auto suggest box. In this auto suggest box you have the name. Say I'll call it as say Nokia. Similarly, I can create another object with object reference. So you will write, I hope my voice is very clear now. Fine. New phone. I'll create another phone object. So basically I'll repeat, I've created this object of the class phone. Okay, and P1 points towards that object. Okay, with P1 you can access the object state, and similarly I have created another object to which P2 will point. Okay, to this object P2 will be pointing, and this object will also have a name property. With P2 I can assign this object a different name. P2 dot name is say iPhone. Alright, if you look at the phone class, there is just one variable name. Okay, but by creating different objects of this phone class, you can give this variable a different state. Okay, you can give it a different value. Fine. Now, what is the difference between object and object reference? Look, references, they point towards objects. Okay, as I told you just now, you have got two objects. And you have got two object references, P1 and P2. Okay, now these references, they point towards objects. Okay, if on this line if I write P2 equals to P1, what will happen? Right, if I look in the diagram, P2 will point towards the location where P1 is pointing. So P2 and P1 will point towards the same object and can change the state of the object. Okay, look, the guys, the meeting is limited to 25 people. Okay, so please join early. Alright, now the thing is, if I write out here system.out.println P1 dot name and P2 dot name, and if I print it, print the same thing after this, right? If I run it, in the output you will see that it first prints Nokia and iPhone. But after that it is only printing Nokia and Nokia, because P2 is pointing towards P1. P1 is Nokia. Okay, so both will print the same. If any one of these references, they change the state of the object. If I write say P1 dot name is say Nexus. And if I again print both of them and run it, it will print Nexus for both. The reason being that either of P1 or P2, if it changes the state of the object, if it changes the name to Nexus, then both will get the updated name. So this is the difference between object and object references. References can move between the objects. Okay, but the objects, they are in the memory, they stay there in the memory. Okay, they can't be moved like that. Alright? Fine. So I hope this point is very clear. And when we work with Selenium, we create objects, and we create objects of existing classes. Okay, now inside the class phone, this is a variable. I can also have a function known as public void call. Right, and I can print over here name of the phone and calling. So what will happen? If I am creating the object of the phone class out here, say p1 dot, if I take p1, I will have the function p1 dot call out here. I can access the function call as well. So call function would also be there inside each and every object. Okay, if I run this, see it's printing Nexus calling in the end, because p1 is calling it, p1 is calling the call function, right? The name of p1 is Nexus, so it is printing Nexus calling. Had it been having a different name, it would have printed that name. So this is known as non-static variable. This is known as a function which is non-static function. Non-static things are the part of the object. Okay. Now suppose take up a scenario. Fine, take up a scenario where you have a variable like this. Say, public int number of. Yeah. Yeah.
How are you calling that object here?
Look,
because they belong to the same package?
Yeah, because they are in the same project and package. So automatically you can access them. You can just create the object of the phone class. It will recognize it. Okay, this phone class has got no main function, and I am also not executing the phone class. Okay. I am not executing the phone class, I am executing the user class. User class is calling the phone class, it is creating the object of that class. Right. Now suppose in the phone class there is a variable known as number of, just a minute. Number of batteries. Okay. Right. Now we all know that all the phones have one battery. Okay. So if I'm creating the object of say phone over here, say P1, P2, for every object I will have to write P1 dot number of batteries equals to 1, then P2 dot number of batteries equals to 1. Right. This number of batteries variable will be associated with every object, and the value would be 1 only. So it looks a little odd that I have to initiate this variable again and again. If I create 10 objects of the phone as well, all 10 objects can have different names, but all 10 objects will have number of batteries to 1. So what we do is that stuff which is common for the objects. Okay, what we do is we hold on, we actually stuff which is common, hold on, we make it static, public static int number of batteries. Okay, right. So what does static means? Static means that if there are number of objects in a class, right? If there are number of objects out here, and if you have an object out, if you make something static, okay, suppose these are the four objects of the phone class. If you make something static, okay, then that static stuff will remain at a common location in the memory. For example, number of batteries. This variable will not be in any object. It would be at a memory location which is common to all the objects. Okay, static is not the part of an object. Please note, static is not part of object. If I open my code now, user.java, you will see yellow lines under number of batteries. You see the yellow line out here? This represents a warning sign that number of batteries is a static variable. Don't access it with the object reference. Rather, static can be accessed like this: the name of the class dot the variable number of batteries, say equals to 1. You can access static stuff in the class with the name of the class and putting a dot sign, but you will not be able to access the other variables. Only the static variables can be accessed. Static variables and functions can be accessed with the name of the class. When you do this, then all the objects would have one battery automatically, because this is a common variable for all the objects, right? So the crux is, in a class you can have this is a static variable. In a class you can have a static variable, you can have a non-static variable, okay, you can have static functions and non-static functions as well. Non-static stuff is the property of the object. Non-static stuff, you need to actually access the non-static stuff by creating the object of the class phone, like something like that. Okay, but static stuff you cannot access it like this. Okay, you can access it directly with the name of the class. Okay, for non-static you need to create the object. Alright, and this is what we use in Selenium. Okay, in Selenium you have got driver classes. Alright, fine. So number of batteries is 1, and this is a static variable. Okay, right, and this is common for everything. Now similarly, you have stuff in Selenium, right? In Selenium you have got drivers for every class. Okay, for example, if I go to the official website of Selenium, that is seleniumhq.org, right? If I go here, and out here, if you go to the download link, you will see the Java doc, which I talked about yesterday as well, that Java docs are present out here. Okay, if I click on the Java doc link, fine, you will have all the classes mentioned out here. Okay, right. Now if you look at all the classes, like there are lots of classes. Look, nobody remembers all these classes, right? These are the classes in Selenium WebDriver inbuilt. These classes, they come to you when you add the jars of Selenium in the project. Okay, so I'll just add the jars inside day 2 project as well, the way I did for day 1 yesterday. Okay, so that my project is Selenium enabled, right? So I have added the jars in reference library section. You will see the jars. If you don't see the reference library section in your Eclipse, okay, make sure you are in the Java perspective. Right now I am in the Java perspective in Eclipse. You can click on this icon out here, this small icon, and a window like this will appear. Okay, in this window you can switch over to the Java perspective. Alright, there are various perspectives. These perspectives are used by the developers and all. You as a tester, you just need to use Java perspective. Okay, right. Now if I look at these classes, right, let me show you something, hold on. There are various driver classes in Selenium. Okay, these are the driver classes. As the name suggests, you will come to know Chrome driver is for Chrome, Edge driver is for the latest Edge browser. Okay, event firing driver, we will talk about it, not right now. Firefox driver is for Firefox, Opera driver for Opera, IE driver is also there. Okay, remote web driver is actually used for Grid. Okay, this is a class which is used in Selenium Grid to execute the test cases parallelly. And Safari driver is something which helps you work on Safari. Okay, but as per my experience, both these Opera drivers and Safari drivers, these both are unstable. Half the things, they don't work with Opera and Safari when you use these drivers. Okay, so the whole course will revolve around these driver classes only. Okay, for example, I'll just create a new class over here, Selenium_basics. Okay, right, with the main function. Now out here, if I create the object of the class Firefox driver, as I explained yesterday, just by creating the object of this inbuilt class, you'll have to import it. Okay, move your mouse over the error and you'll see the import option. You'll have to import it. Just by creating the object of this class, right, if I execute this program, right, a blank Firefox window will open up. You see that? But if I want to handle this window, suppose I want to navigate to some website or something, okay, I'll have to create the object reference. I'll have to write like this, Firefox driver say fd equals to new Firefox driver. So Firefox driver has this reference fd, and if I write fd dot, you will get lot of functions which are associated with this driver when we'll be using these functions in the class. Okay, for example, fd.get is one of the functions in which you give the URL of the website where you want to visit. Make sure you are giving the protocol. It is not QTP. QTP spares you. In QTP, if you just write bbc.com, it will work. But in Selenium, if you don't write the protocol and run it, you will get an exception. Okay, hold on, I'll show you. If you run this and you see, just a minute, you see that you get an exception, web driver exception. Okay, so you need to give the protocol like this, it's mandatory. Alright, and now if I run this, this will open the browser and it will take the browser to bbc.com. Right? Fine. So this is how Firefox driver works. Similarly, there are other driver classes, Chrome driver, Internet Explorer driver, right? So to work with every browser, you have an inbuilt driver classes with inbuilt static and non-static functions. If I write Firefox driver dot, you will have access to all the static stuff in this class. Okay, we'll talk about that. I'm just telling you right now, just to give you the information. Right, similarly, you have got drivers for other browsers like Chrome driver. I'll write Chrome driver cd equals to new. Look, in Selenium there is a very good feature, or in Java with Eclipse there is a very good feature. Now if I don't know how to write Chrome driver, you can just write ch, okay, and hit the control space bar of your keyboard. It will give you all the classes starting with CH. So as you keep on typing, these would be sorted out. And the one which I want is Chrome driver. So you can select that. Say Chrome driver CD equals to new. Again I can write, say you will get the first option, Chrome driver. Control space bar. Okay. Now suppose I wrote FD dot and I use the get function. I want to use, say I want to check out the other functions as well. So you place your cursor in front of dot, okay, and hit control space bar. You will get the other functions as well. Okay. So control space bar does lots of good things in Eclipse in bringing up the auto suggests. Okay. Right. Now let me comment this. I'll write Chrome driver CD equals to new Chrome driver and then CD dot get to the URL, say HTTP yahoo.com. Okay. When I run this, immediately I'll get this exception. All of you will get this. Okay. Look, for Chrome driver, you need to download an exe file from Selenium website. It will not work directly by creating the object of Chrome driver, no. Okay, you need to go to the Selenium website and on Selenium website you will see third party browser drivers not developed by Selenium HQ. Okay, this is the Google Chrome driver, you click on it and you will go here, latest release 2.20, go here. Hold on. Yes, this is the URL. Okay, storage. You click on this and you will be taken to this thing. And just go to the latest one, which is 2.20. Okay. And under that, you will see various zip files. Okay. Corresponding to your OS, download it. If you have a 64-bit Windows OS, you can download the 32-bit as well. That is not a problem. Okay. When you download it and extract it, what you will get is this file, chromedriver.exe. Okay. Don't run this. There is no use in running it. Okay. You will not get anything. If I run this, you will see a screen coming up and nothing else. Okay. You need to write the code like this. Okay, you need to write the code like this. You need to set a system property. Okay, system dot set property function. Look, system is an inbuilt class. Okay, inside this class, this is an inbuilt class in Java. There is a function known as set property. This is a static function. That is why I am able to call it directly with the name of the class. Okay, because static can be accessed directly with the name of the class. I am setting a system property known as, you need to write like this, webdriver.chrome.driver. And the path to the Chrome driver exe which you have downloaded. Okay, fdrive chromedriver.exe. In my PC, it is in fdrive. Right. Don't think that I am hard coding the path and all right now. I am not. My motive right now is not to make a dynamic code or something. It is just to explain you the basics right now. Okay. So when you write like this, you have to set the property webdriver.chrome.driver. And when you write like this and run it, now Chrome will open. Okay. You see that? Chrome opens. And it goes to yahoo.com. Fine. Now there is one thing out here. People make a mistake. They sometimes keep the W of web driver capital. It will not work. Java is a case sensitive language. If I run this, I'll get an exception again. Okay. You need to keep the W in the lower case. Everything should be in lower case. Webdriver.chrome.driver. Right. And another thing. which is important is, if I look at the task manager, okay, if I look at my task manager, you will find, see that Chrome driver.exe is running even if I close the Chrome browser. Okay, this exe will keep on running even though your program ends. Okay, Chrome driver.exe will keep on running. If I run this program again, once again, right, Chrome will start, it will go to yahoo.com. fine. If I manually close Chrome as well, okay, I'll manually close Chrome. Fine. If I look at the taskbar, you see now two Chrome driver.exes are running because I had executed my code two times. You need to make sure that you quit these exes, otherwise they can also hamper the system performance or something. Okay, so it is very important to use the quit command in the end. Quit command will end the Selenium session. It will close the browser and it will also close the exes. Okay, so this is very important, especially when you are using Selenium Grid and all. If you have to free the node, then you always need to quit the driver. Right, now similarly, you have got Internet Explorer driver, which is for internet. I'll just write INTER, hit the control space bar. I'll get this Internet Explorer driver, I equals to new Internet Explorer driver. Okay, right. Now you write over here I dot get, go to the URL http yahoo.com. I'll just comment the Chrome part. Right, if I run this again, I will get an exception. Look, iDriver, you have to be very very careful. Okay, there are few rules which you should follow when you are working with I. The first thing is that for I, you have got another exe file which has to be downloaded, similar to Chrome. Okay, you go to the website of Selenium, go to the download section, and you will find Internet Explorer driver server over here. Okay, depending on your I, whether your I is 32 bit or I is 64 bit, I am not talking about your PC. Okay, I is also 32 bit or 64 bit. Okay, depending on it, download the exe file. In my PC, I have downloaded and kept it over here, idriverserver.exe. And again, you need to write system.setProperty webdriver.i.driver. Everything in lowercase. Okay, don't keep anything in uppercase. Alright, and the value will be fdrive idriverserver.exe. Fine. Okay, now another thing, when you are working with I, make sure that in I, under the view section, right, the zoom level is set to 100%. If the zoom level is not set to 100%, it will not work properly. Okay, it will not work properly. Fine. Now, another thing was, if you go to tools, Internet options. Fine. Under security, you will have various tabs. Okay, internet, local internet, trusted site, restricted sites. If your code is not working, make sure that this leveler is at the same location. I prefer it to turn it off. Okay, I bring the leveler to the lowermost position for all the four tabs. Okay, do that. It'll start working. Fine. This leveler bring it to the lowermost section if your code doesn't work. Okay, so when I run this code, you see that I starts, and in the task manager as well you will see the same thing happening. I driver server exe starts. So you can quit the exe, you can call the function driver.quit. I.quit. Okay, there is a question being asked that why we need to set 100%. Sritha, this is how Selenium is made. This is how it works with IE. Okay, in IE, lot of restrictions are there. Okay, you have lot of security stuff and all. So make sure your zoom level is set to 100% and it will only work in that case. Okay, sometimes it works. If I make my, say, zoom level to say 400%. Okay, I close my eye, if I run this program, fine, it works fine, but for many people it doesn't work. Okay, so I've seen this practically, things happening in, especially in IE 11 or something. I've got IE 8 right now. Okay, so hold on, see, some exception came up. I think this is for the zoom level only. Unexpected error launching. Yeah, you see that an exception had come up. Browser zoom level was set to 400%. It should be set to 100%. So you know, it doesn't work at times, it doesn't work. So you need to be very, very careful. All right, fine. So these are the three drivers, these are the primary three drivers with which you work. Now there are other drivers as well. For example, there is a driver known as, this is very interesting, HTML unit driver. HTML unit driver, yeah. Say dr equals to new HTML unit driver. Okay, and I'll write, say, dr dot get to the website, say http://bbc.com. And you print driver.getTitle. Driver.getTitle command gets you the title of the current page which is opened. Okay, if I run this, you will see nothing happening. No browser will open, nothing will happen. Alright, but the title of the BBC page is printed in the output. What HTML unit driver does? Okay, HTML unit driver is a silent driver. It doesn't open any browser. It sends silent request to the server, gets the response and works with the response. It's very fast because physically no browser is being opened. Okay, it will send the request to the website, it will get the response, it will interact with the response, it can again send the request back, right? And especially, like, for example, you have a Unix interface where you, in Unix you interface, everything is like shell, right? You don't have any browser installed or something. If you want to execute a script on the Unix interface where there are no browsers installed and all, you can use HTML driver over there. Okay, right, fine. So this is what HTML driver does in crux. I've just given you an overview, right? And okay, I'll just check it out after the class, because you know, hardly 2-3, just wait a minute, just I'll be very careful in switching my screens. Okay, so basically I talked about Firefox driver, Chrome driver, IE driver and HTML unit driver. Alright, Now there are other drivers as well, which I had told you, Safari driver and Opera driver, which are unstable. Things they don't work properly in these drivers. Managing pop-ups, different windows, and all of them just simply fail. Okay, sometimes elements don't even get recognized properly. Okay, so these are the driver classes. Alright, now anybody having any questions till now? Any questions regarding the course, regarding whatever I've taught you today? Any questions? Anybody with any questions before I move ahead? Hello? Guys, please keep your microphones on mute. Pardon? Look, as I told you, if you want to execute your scripts faster, you can use it. If you want to run it on Unix, where there is no browser installed, there is shell. Okay, Unix is like this command prompt. Right, so you can use HTML driver over there, unit driver over there. Okay, another question being asked is, will you help in interview? Look, the thing is, if you look at the website which we have, right, look, it takes around 2 months to learn this tool to a way that you can actually clear an interview. Okay, if you look at our website and if you look at the pre-recorded sessions which you have and which you will be getting along with the training, okay, there is a last module for 3 hours. It's on interview questions, training module 45. Okay, but don't watch it directly, watch it after learning everything. Alright, this module is purely on interview questions. Alright. Anybody else with any questions? Right. Now moving ahead. Yeah, Raj, tell me what question you have. Yes. Sometimes I'll send you the today's link as well. Like sometimes you have got applications. Right, applications like this. Flipkart.com, if I go here, okay, and if I go to any section, say t-shirts, fine. If I scroll down, look, hold on, let me go to any brand. If I scroll down, then more and more products will appear. Okay, there are websites these days, right? Then that if I scroll down, then more and more products, they are loaded. This is Ajax. So if you want to simulate the same thing with Selenium, you can do it. I'll show you in the training how to do it. Okay, that's possible. Yeah.
So it won't be by default
on this page, suppose 10 products they come up by default, but if you scroll down, 10 more will load. And if you further scroll down, if you keep on scrolling down, more and more products will keep on loading. So you can simulate this with Selenium as well. You can do everything, whatever in browser, you can do everything. No. It should be present. Look, I will be covering frameworks, right? There are lots of frameworks. Data-driven framework is there, keyword-driven, hybrid, page object model. Generally in the class, we go for page object model. It's a kind of data-driven framework only. Yeah. Alright, anybody else with any question? Right. So, now, Yeah, that will be covered. Yes, annotations and all, everything will be covered. That comes under TestNG and all, everything. Okay. Right. Now, Yeah, tell me. That will start after day 7 or day 8. Okay. Yeah, that's what I'll tell. Let me teach you a few basics. Once we are done, I have a lot of exercises with me. From day 7, day 8, I'll give you a lot of exercises to do. Okay. Once some background is built, I'll give you. Okay. Right. Now, I have taught you about all the drivers in this class. But what if I have to execute a site on different browsers? Say I want to open bbc.com and I want to test it on all the browsers. I cannot create the driver for every browser separately. I cannot just create the object for every driver separately and test it. Right? So that's what I'll be covering tomorrow. Okay, concept of interfaces and all, and how they help us, the interface concept in Java, how it helps us to actually test on multiple browsers, okay, dynamically, right? So we'll cover that tomorrow. Okay, I'll stop for today. Fine.